Welcome everyone, good afternoon. Today we have the pleasure of having Pere Palle as our speaker. Pere got his PhD degree in astrophysics in 1986 in Universidad de La Laguna in Spain. And same year he joined the IAC as a permanent researcher, as a principal investigator also at Instituto de Astrofísica de Canarias. And since then he has been working as in different positions, but mostly as a project coordinator at IAC since 1989. Also, he served as the head of the IAC research division between 1999 and 2003. His main research activities are involved in instrumentation, observations, data reduction, and physical interpretation in the domains of mostly helioseismology, both from ground networks and space-based instruments. He has been involved in several teaching positions at IAC at the Universidad de La Laguna, teaching nuclear physics, solar physics, and digital signal processing. And he has supervised, I believe, 4 PhD theses so far. And he is responsible for many activities at IAC, including solar laboratory at the Observatory del Teide at IAC, where up to 6 helio and astroseismology projects are, instruments are continuously operated. And he's also responsible for the GOM, Global Oscillations Network Group, and the Bison project at IAC. And he's the principal investigator of IAC's internal project called Helio and Astroseismology and Exoplanets Research. He's involved in many other activities, and currently he's also responsible for the European Union FP7 programs, ASK and SPACEN at IAC. And with that, Pere.
Thank you very much. Well, first of all, I would like to thank HAO Directorate, his director, Mike Thompson, and many of the people here at HAO, starting with the administration people, Beverly, Wendy. They make possible a warm stay here during 2 months. And of course, my old friends here, as Steve, and some other younger friends, as Gulnur, Savita, and well, I have seen old friends around, like Martin Buder, and also new friends like Travis. So once saying that, I must, before any comment about my talk, I think today it's an important day for HAO, because just a few hours ago, the successful launch of Sunrise 2 from Sweden took place. Now it seems that the balloon with the instrument is just already here. This was a couple of hours ago. And this is the moment of the launch. You can see, not very well, this is a picture from Valentin, one of the ISC scientists there. This is the telescope and the balloon. And in this project, HAO has been very much involved successfully in the Sunrise 1, and we wish all the best for Sunrise 2. So Steve, as head of the instrumentation division here, I think also he deserves some congratulations. No?
From me.
Then?
No. You are the spot. Yeah. So the second thing is that, as Gulnur says, well, Gulnur says many things, but probably the most important is that I am an observer. This is the main thing. And it's funny because I reached the research phase when I finished my undergraduate studies, just when this answer that was posed 8 years ago got an answer. The answer to that question that Arthur Eddington posed 8 years ago was how we can access the interior of the stars. And the answer came in 79, when, you know, the answer is helioseismology or asteroseismology is the group. So I just started research when this question was solved. So you can imagine that I went into this field because it was really very exciting at that time. So I went completely to helioseismology. And helioseismology is a branch in which HAO people has contributed a lot on the observational point of view, instrumentation, data analysis, modeling, so has been really an outstanding contribution from HAO to the development of the heliosismology and also asteroseismology. Right now, this range is not too enhanced or here, so I was thinking not in giving a talk exclusively in heliosismology, but to look for some broader topic which can interest to other people of the HAO. So, also I was told that the philosophy of this colloquium was to give a more general view of some aspect or some problem. So, what I decide is to get this title, The Circular Measurements of the Solar Gravitational Redshift. Of course, the word solar, it means that we are related with solar physics, which is true, and probably gravitational redshift is something that can attract to other people to the talk, says, well, what else is that? So this is the idea of the talk. The motivation, the real motivation was also first to get this scientific exploitation of the Sun as a Star radial velocity observational data set that is unique. It's unique because it's homogeneous, has a long temporal coverage, more than 3 solar cycles, almost 40 years, has a high continuity, high sensitivity and precision to measure the line of sight velocity of the Sun relative to the instrument, and the most important thing to me and the unique feature of this instrument, as you will see, is that it has extremely high long-term stability. So it makes the ideal instrument to look for the offset variations along the decades. I love this instrument. It's an old instrument, I can see, but it's also one of my favorite things. Once we get over this data set analysis, we'll focus in how we determine the solar gravitational redshift and analyze what's his temporal behavior. The instrument, our loved instrument, it's called Mark I. Mark I is because it was the first of a series, but then the other ones were different, so the name remains as Mark I. It's a solar spectrophotometer, working with its atomic beam, narrow band filter, working with resonance scattering technique at the potassium line. Very simple. What you do, it's a direct comparison of the wavelengths of the light emitted by your source with the wavelength of atomic transitions of some atoms under stable and controlled conditions. In our case, we are unperturbed and in vacuum. So by this direct comparison of wavelengths with atomic transitions, wavelengths of atomic transitions, you can measure the Sun as a Star radial velocity. It was a non-instrument. I told you it was conceived in the 60s. Developed and tested with the SAC in the mid-70s, and since then it's continuously operated and scientifically exploited up to now. So I don't think in the astrophysics field of any other instrument that have been giving good quality data in a continuous way for 40 years. Not in the solar area, not in the so it deserves, and it's in order to present to the instrument builders something very rare today. We have few instrument builders in our research area building new things. So these are the builders. Here are the names. Mostly was conceived and developed at the University of Birmingham. These are the actors. Most of them could be known by you. And it's important to say that this guy that was a PhD student in 77 was the founder of the heliosismology group at the IAC, Professor Roca. Of course, was my supervisor, and I was his first PhD student. And since then, we are working together. So these are the guys in 78. And this is something funny, that 4 years before that picture, Professor Isaac, the leader of the group, just put on his handbook his original notes, and even before the discovery of the 5 minute oscillation as a global process, a global pulsation of the whole Sun, he just saw 5 years ago that in a few a short observations taken at the roof of the Birmingham University, you can imagine that the weather there is not very nice in terms of solar observations. So he wrote something that he observed in the radial velocity of the sun as a star that more or less was of the order of 5 minutes. So because Professor Isaac was also one of my PhD supervisors, I would like to show this here. I'm sorry. So this instrument was really important in the 80s and 90s because it was the instrument in which the global nature of the 5 minute oscillations and the discrete structure of this one was discovered. There were many other observations of the 5 minute oscillation for 15 years before that, or even more, but were never observed in the global sun, so they were thought the origin to be other than the global modes, the normal modes. And this was the discovery in 79, followed by a much more better quality the data obtained in South Pole by the French group. So, other things we did with this instrument was the first proof that the network concept, it works. Soon after the discovery of the 5 minutes, we noticed that the spectrum, when we analyzed the spectrum, was highly contaminated due to the pollution of the day-night gaps. If you observe the sun from one single side, you have interruptions during the night, and this produces spurious power in the power spectrum. So to overcome this problem, what we thought is to prove in 1981 to put a similar instrument to Mark I in Haleakala. Then we do combine observations from Tenerife and Hawaii, means Haleakala. And this is the original plot we made in 81. These colors and the scale, I just edited the plot, so we're not part of the original one. No color printer at that time, at least accessible to us. So it's everything in one color, but you can see here very clear the overlapped region. Here it's my scene. This is the Haleakala signal. This is only Tenerife signal, and in the middle the overlap. So since then, as you might know, the strategy of networks has become standard. We got ground-based networks in Helios seismology, Bison, Gong, even Echo, Steve Tomczyk developed a mini network for years, and a space looking for continuity. But this was the first proof, the observational proof, that the concept was going to work. And also, even it was a single instrument, this Mark I, in the mid-80s, for the first time, we studied in a systematic way, 15 years along, the variation of the sensitivity of the power spectrum of the T-modes to the degree of activity in the sun, the famous frequency shifts. This was first discovered by Boulder and Hudson, Martin is here, years early, when they compared 2 points in the measurements of the SMM satellite in photometry. But this was the first systematic study since 76 up to 88. Since then, you know, from one side you can do also nice things. This is only one side, one instrument, the frequency shifts up till 2000 compared with different activity indices. Of course, with only one instrument in one side as compared with the networks, you cannot compete the quality of the data obtained with the heliosismology networks and from the space is much better than the one you have from one single instrument. So this is the instrument, very simple, I will not describe too much. It's, as I told, it's the resonance scattering technique. You have here a cell, which is one centimeter square. You have the image of the sun here, but this image gathered with the cirrostat has been filtered, polarized, and circularly polarized every 1 second in order to get circular light here, left or hand side. And all this is in a parallel magnetic field. what we do is that, well, this technique, I think, is known here at the JO. A further improvement in this instrument was made by Cacciani and later with Steve, in which you have a combination of cells and you can have an image of the sun, not the sun as a star. Working principle, it's very easy. You have the solar line coming into the instrument. This is the potassium 7699 line. And these are the two components produced by the Zeeman splitting, the Zeeman transitions inside the cell. Each component is sensitive to only one sense of the polarized light. So when the incident line is polarized in the right side or the left side, only one of these components is measured. So we switch every second between the two sides. This incoming line light is polarized every 1 second. So every second we are measuring or here, the number of photons. It's obvious that if there is not a relative velocity between the sun and our instrument, roughly the two counts will be the same. So L equals R, so will be not velocity. What happens if there is a relative movement between the sun and our instrument? Well, the solar line will be shifted, let's assume to the right, and then in that case, L counts will be higher than R counts. In the first approximation, the difference between of these countings is proportional to the line of sight velocity between the sun and our AD instrument. This L plus R figure here down on the denominator is just to correct for the fluctuations of the whole light coming from the sun early morning, midday, or afternoon. So it corrects to the first order this change in the counts. So basically, this instrumental velocity, remember this has not any dimension, these are photons divided by photons, is a non-dimensional magnitude, so you need to calibrate somehow to obtain the velocity. The instrument, well, 40 years working. One of the important things is that the main components, the key components of the instrument, have not changed since 76. For instance, the interference filter, cell, I will comment on that, the electro-optical light modulator, the device that makes the circular modulation of the light, etc. This has remained unchanged. Only major changes at dates took place in electronics, control system, zero start guiding, etc. As you can imagine, and as I will show. It has been moved, this instrument, even to three different places in our observatory. Since 87, it's in the pyramid, named Van der Rij, because one of the pioneers of the group, already died years ago, was very involved with our group at the observatory. So he's there. And now with the actual technology, we have a quasi-remote operation of the instrument. But because we have a stylostat, we need a daily manpower to align for the operations of alignment and stall of the stylostat. For those of you that don't know our observatory, in Teide, one of the islands of the Canary Archipelago, this is located east from La Palma Island, where my telescopes are. This is the east-west view of the observatory, the solar towers. Remember, last week, Jan Stenflo was talking about Themis observations. This is Themis telescope, where he performed observations on the solar towers. Our area is just on the other side, so you cannot see it, but you people will see. For the young people, this is how instrumentation looks like in 76. So don't, this is real life, okay? And the data obtained here is as good as the one we are obtaining now with all the digital devices and computers. So just imagine this was a digital tape, 7 tracks, not even 9 tracks, which probably some of us are habituated. So this is the old instrument as it was until 83. Some small improvements with small microcomputers. Now this is a BBC microcomputer. And this is the box, this black box is the one that contains the instrument. Okay, now it looks nicer because the Linux system that you can control everything. This is how it looks like, our instruments. We have always many instruments, proving things, developing new prototypes, you know, in ATC. And this is the solar lab, the pyramid, where in this terrace up here or down here, we can locate Zerostat and send the light directly into the lab. One of the advantages of this instrument is that the instrument itself is inside of the lab. So outside, what you have is a simple but efficient Zerostat system, servo control, of course. You control the movement, the mechanical movement. And one particular thing is that we need to change the mounting type. This is, you see, this is the primary mirror that follows the sun, sends the light to the secondary mirror, which is fixed, and this sends the light into the lab. Here again, this is the primary, moving with the sun, the secondary fixed, and into the lab. So this is mounted in an equatorial line. It means that the image of the sun inside of the cell does not rotate during the day. And this is very important. If you choose another arrangement of the zerostat, such that you have no shadow at midday, in fact, we must change from summer to winter because during the equinox, we have some shadow. The sun is over there and there is the shadow. Here in winter, sun is here at the west side, so we have no shadow. In summer, the sun is to the north, to the right, so we have no shadow. But in the solstice, we have a 1 hour shadow in the middle. But on the other way, our image inside of the cell does not rotate along the day, and this is important. Well, the process of aligning this instrument every morning must be, as I told you, made by a person. It's not automatic, but this again ensures the quality of the alignment every day. This is very, very important. An idea of what the database consists on, the observations. Well, it covers 37 years. Up to 84, were not too much people at the observatory to take care of a continuous observations all the year long. So we mainly perform summer campaigns. But then since 85 till present, each possible day of in which we have sun, in good weather conditions, we have observed with this instrument. Of course, this was possible because we have used PhD students, graduate people, postdocs, staff, operators. I count that up to now, more than 70 people have been using or observing with this Mark I instrument. In fact, one of our summer students was Hector Socas, well known here at HAO, so he also made observations with this instrument. What do you have? We have, for this period in which was non-interrupted the data, we have more than almost 8,000 days of data, and the duty cycle shift is some of the order of 64% of the possible time. This is really a high duty cycle. Amazing thing, and something that says really an important characteristic of the instrument is that it's very robust. Our losses due to instrumental failures are below 0.3%, what represents more or less one observing day lost every year, in average, of course. Just an idea of the data distribution, the percentage of good time we have relative to the possible hours of sun. Each row, I think, it's 10 years. This last bit, it's December last year, 2003. And of course, as any observatory, we have a major seasonal variations in the duty cycle, in the hours of sun. This is the standard of 30 years Februarys, and 30 Junes, data, 30 years Junes data. So you can see that in June, you have a mean over the month of about 70%, 75%, and a worst month in February, you can have some 35% to 40%. So this is normal, and compared with other observatories, it's more or less what you expect. it is important, and you'll see why, to control what has happened with the instrument. Remember, we will look for solar cycle or secular effects of 30 to 40 years. So we need to be very careful in what has been happening with the instrument. We managed after many years to get this e-running book in which we note for every day what has happened, what incidents has happened of any kind, electronics, optics. For instance, you see how systematically we change our mounting from summer to winter. It takes place every year. You will see that is a row that is almost empty. You see this row number, Row number six is almost empty, and it corresponds precisely to the change on the cell. Here we tried a new type of cell, two types of cell. We did a like and we went back to the original cell. So for all this period, the cell, which is the heart of the instrument, has remained the same. And finally, a couple of years ago, we decided to change it, and you will understand why. This is the cell. This is one centimeter, the cube, that we remove after 25 years. Of course, this is running at 120 degrees all the time, day and night, 24 hours per day during 20 years. So you get some attack of the windows of the cell by the not precisely by the potassium, but it could contain some residual of sodium. Steve is a whole expert on this kind of business, even with new types of glass. This is the new cell. You will see that it's not affected. Well, just to let that, in the last 10 years, we are able to control a lot the housekeeping and the data. So it's very important to know. In summary, what do we observe? Well, roughly what we observe every day, it's this different left minus right along 10 hours since the early morning to the night. And if you make this computation and divide, you will find a sine wave. Why? Because the observed velocity Sun-Earth, at the sun as a star, it's a combination of orbital, spin velocity, gravitational redshift, and these terms. The dominant term is the sinusoidal due to the rotation of the Earth. In the morning, the Earth is facing to you, you are rotating towards the sun, okay, it's a blue shift, and in the evening you are going, redshift from the sun, yet and midday is zero. So every observation has this sine wave modulation, which amplitude is very well known from ephemeris. You can compute with the precision of pulse in centimeters per second what this amplitude is every day for any observatory. So it basically tells you a way to calibrate the data. Of course, in this equation, that is the orbital velocity, the spin velocity, a fixed term that we know will exist, we'll talk about the gravitational redshift, we put here an extra term that is any unknown velocity field that is constant during the time of observation, so that during one day, velocity fields on the surface of the sun that are more or less constant, plus the oscillations. This term, it's of the order of 1 meter per second, but these ones can achieve the quantity of 1 kilometer or more. So this is a minor term. In summary, every day we can calibrate the observation just by fitting an appropriate sine wave here, some other business, and obtain a value for the calibration and a value for the sum of these two terms. We cannot, you know, separate the gravitational redshift and this other term that we don't know what it is, but we can start to figure out. The limb shift, for instance, it's a known thing. Idea to keep is that you can calculate the offset, but it depends on the calibration. So it's tied to how well do you fit that, because it's a calibration. So the residuals of a given day, the famous 5 minutes of oscillation, this is 10 hours of observation, a standard output, and also the standard output of the 5 minutes envelope. This is a single day, 8 hours of observation of the instrument. So even say that, let's go to the talk. Gravitational redshift. What is it? You know that it's one of the four tests of the general relativity, together with the others. So light emit by a massive body is redshift when you receive it, because to the gravitational potential field of the body. On the other way, you can have a blue shift. So in the case of the sun, this is the formula. Depends on the mass of the sun, in this case, when the light is emitted, and the mass of the Earth, and the distance amongst them. From general relativity, this term works out to be 636 meters per second. Well, I must say that in the end of the 19th century, already solar physicists knew that the light, the spectral lines, the solar spectral lines were redshifted. But I thought was due to pressure shifts. But in 1911, when was published the general relativity and the principle of equivalence of mass, people was encouraged to observe this quantity that was, you know, calculated or was obtained from this theoretical calculation. So there was a lot of activity measuring or trying to measure the gravitational redshift of the sun. And people soon realized that was a complex problem, because the gravitational redshift velocity is not the unique one. You have other velocity fields on the sun, you have collision effects, you know, it was a very complex measurement to do, because it was a mixture of different physical processes on the sun. People try here on Earth, and mainly since the Mosbauer effect was discovered, it was measured from the Earth, on the Earth, and they receive sensitivities of 10%, 15%. With the atomic beam, the solar measurements performed with atomic beam instruments, like the ones I'm talking about, Mach 1 and others, one could go below 1%. So few meters per second. So again, how we measure this quantity? Well, we don't like this way, because it depends on the calibration. So it's not an independent measurement. Let's look for another technique, much more simple and robust and independent of the calibration. If you look at the observed velocity, this is real observations, daily observations in different times of the year, you will see that always you have a sine wave, okay? But this sine wave is shifted up and down in velocity. Why? Because the orbital velocity of the Earth relative to the sun, it varies along the year as the Earth evolves along the sun. So in April, we have the maximum orbital velocity of the Earth relative to the sun, which is 500 meters per second, and the curve, the daily curve, is up here. And here in October, we have the minimum or the most negative orbital velocity of the Earth relative to the sun. So the curves are down here. Let's look what happens here in this zoom. Let's zoom. Look, there are days in which the total velocity goes from negative to positive values. It happens in our observatory from August to December, beginning of December. So we have 4 months in which at some time of the day, this velocity closes to zero. That's the key. That's the way to measure. Why? Because if you are able to measure at which time this curve crosses to zero, you can obtain directly the value of these two guys as a combination of the ephemeris values. You don't need to calibrate your data. Remember, if you put zero here, okay, the total velocity is zero, you can get out, and you filter out appropriately this oscillation term of 1 meter per second, you can deduce what the sum is. So this is a nice and a clever way to obtain this offset, the total offset, independently of the calibration. You just need to measure accurately at which time, at which precise time the crossing takes place, and to have a good computation of the ephemeris, positions below 1 centimeter per second, and an accurate timing. 1 second error in your timing would give you errors of 3 centimeters per second. Remember, most of you are not habituated to work with this magnitude so low. Many people work with meters per second. Here we are talking about one or two orders of magnitude below. So we need to be very careful, extremely careful with all this. So for any annual period from August to December, we can, in the good days, calculate what's the sum of the BGRS plus B0. I will call it gravitational redshift for the moment. This is one example, 1996. Look at the error bars. This is the error on the crossing time estimation. This is tensing error bars. And this curve is similar to the one that makes the orbital velocity. You see the modulation of the moon here, very clear. So first thing, the mean value is not 636, but 605. So we have a 5% blue shift, okay, relative to the transient value. Of course, one wonders what B0 will be. The second thing is that there is a fluctuation. Okay, this is not flat. Amplitude varies with years. This is for the whole years, the raw data that comes out from all the analysis of these 37 years for each period in which we have a crossing. So, okay, you can see here a lot of effects going up and down. Probably some of you will start to see something that tends to change. To measure the offset of an instrument, it's very delicate thing. You must be very careful about all the systematics. Systematics is something that people don't use to pay, in my opinion, too much attention, or at least the attention it deserves. Systematics is important if you measure offset stuff. So you understand why we take care about the control of any parameters that could influence our measurements. So if you remember that table I put with all the incidences that took place during 40 years, changing of mirrors, electronics, etc. If you put here on top of that, you'll see something for that. We have, for each time of the year, information on what has happened. Sometimes what has happened here has not influenced data. It's just that that day some component of some box was broken, we replaced the component and that's okay. Or some people were just outside, or was some fire and there was a smoke, or etc. Or we replaced the mirrors. So we carefully analyze all the incidents and see what has been the effect on the data. So this is not an easy task, I can assure you. In some cases, because of the knowledge we have of our instrument, we can go correct for it. For instance, this is in 2009 when we decide to change the cell. Okay, so here this is the crossing in August, was very flat. Remember, this is 1%. So here we changed the cell, and of course it took us a week to tune the cell at the right temperature. Okay, each cell has a tuned temperature in which the operation is the optimum. So during these days, of course, everything goes up and down. But look here, this is another cell with the settings go properly, and you see that this really it's flat, so has not affected the offset. Other times there is a problem, and we solve it. For instance, here you can see the blue signal, zoop, here going down. This coincides, according our ebook, with the zero-stat mounting change. Sometimes when you change the zero-stat, the mounting, the alignment, mostly the alignment of the input beam into the electro-optical light modulator, the polarizing, the circular polarizing element, could produce some shift. And here, since we know why, we can go correct for it, you know, just shifting everything. So this plot is also nice because you'll see that this corresponds to 91. This corresponds to, I don't think what is more easy to look. I cannot check it. It's 2009. 2009 was a minimum activity period. Look at this signal. 91 was an active, was the maximum. Look at the signal. This signal, although it's flat, has a fluctuation of 13 days period. Why? Because we are observing the whole sun. We don't see the rotation of the sun because it is canceled right and left, so we don't see rotation. But if sunspots appear on the surface of the sun and cross, that takes 13 days, it produces you a modulation of the signal. At least a modulation. You can have other effects if the line shape is changed. So, but at least you have a quasi-photometric effect due to the passage of the sunspot. So this we noticed already many years ago, that the signal is modulation up to 5 meters per second due to activity. Well, what we did is let's try to model and to remove it from our signal to leave it flat. We have a nice problem that it's a numerical model of the instrument, in the sense that takes a solar line, takes the two lap lines, makes the convolution of them, and works out with all the parameters what's the measurement you are doing. So you can reproduce exactly with this numerical model what the spectrometer is measuring. Here is a bit more complex because we just model quiet regions of the sun with all the velocity fields we know of, with the proper parameters, literature, observations, and we try to model the sunspot regions. First, what we did is for these 40 years to get all the database of daily area and sunspots of any element during these 40 years, for every time of the day, for every month, for every year, for 40 years. So you have a whole database with the area, the position, and so on. We have for these lines how the line profile changed. These are observations of the potassium line in sunspots. We use models for the umbra and the penumbra intensities, the relative intensity, and we do our best to reproduce the signal that we are measuring with the instrument. Aim is to obtain for every day the simulated BGRS plus B0. So, just to clarify you a little bit, this is the output of the problem when you just put a false sunspot, a nice one, at 20 degrees of latitude, an area of 1,000, etc., and you let run the problem. What you obtain? You obtain that as the sunspot appears on the east, it produces a maximum signal, then it's going to the center, going to the mid west hemisphere, and back to the limb. This is 13 days. You'll notice that the maximum effect is at mid, at halfway between the limb and the center. Okay, near the center, the effect is lower because the projection velocity field is perpendicular. So this is 13 days, then nothing because the sunspot was back. It's coming back again. This is a false sunspot. It's just to understand a little bit how the problem works. And this is real simulation of 2 years with the actual sunspot database. 2001, you can see the fluctuations due to the not only to the spots, but also remember here we are using different spectral lines in sunspot regions. And here is in the minimum. So in the minimum, the value of the BGRS is flat. And here it's more or less the same value, but it fluctuates because of the activity.
You worry about faculty?
Yeah, that's the whole point, yeah. Yes, the faculty is one, it is my conclusions. The faculty is not yet there, mainly because you don't have faculty data for these 40 years. And this is one, but yes, it's something to be taken into account. So this is a simple model to try to understand our observations. And I can advance the results that what we see is not dependent on how good our model is. There are some results that are independent. Any case, here you will see that our model is not perfect. This is comparing observed BGLS plus the simulated one. And you can see that not all the small details are corrected. Some are. Sometimes are out of phase. Because remember, we are putting activity, we are deforming the line according to the observations we have in sunspots, but it's just an approximation. So here, you see that this is a maximum, 88. You can see here how this big feature that one can think, well, this is my instrument that was not stable during these 20 days. Well, the model reproduced quite well this variation, but at the end you have some residuals because, of course, our instrument is not perfect. Some of these errors are due to our instrument. Some more examples. You see here, for instance, in 2008, this is the observation, this is the model, flat, yes, because the sun was completely white, was no sunspot at all, so that's why. So the difference is, again, basically the same signal as we had before. Here, it's, I think it's a maximum. You can see that some features are taken into account and some others are not, okay? So this is the first approach to observations, but here it's one interesting thing. If you just take the mean annual value of the simulated BGLS, what you find is that yearly these annual values have a sigma, a spread, a height that is perfectly correlated with the solar cycle. Of course, if you have less signal from the sunspot, the dispersion, the standard deviation is lower. So it's nice, but here we start to show that the mean value of the simulation is affected. And it seems to be anti-correlated. This is very small. This is very small. But our model is not properly calibrated. It could be a factor of 2 or 3. We are not in the model concerned about absolute magnitudes because we know all the weak points of the evolution, but we are concerned about these variations a long time. This is not induced by any other effect than the model itself and the poor physics that we are putting inside. This is the yearly, the average over 1 year of a single BGLS observed. You see the error bars, and here we obtain again a mean value that is not 636, but it's again lower. And here, since we have all the information, we have arguments to exclude this, for instance, data in 76. In 76, the mirror quality was very poor, very simple mirrors. With a system of 3 mirrors, so the image was rotating. We had problems with electronics. And same arguments, we know that this data is not good as far as offset is concerned. Still is good data to see the oscillations, but not in the offset. We had a problem with these three guys here. You see, this is good data, really is very good in quality for oscillations. But the offsets of every year seems to be out of place. We have been working a lot with this 4 years data, and our conclusion was that there was a misalignment of or the incidence angle of the solar beam in the circular modulator has changed. So I will always mark as a consequence these 3 points that you can bring all together down with a shift. So in any of the results here, I will show with and without. If you remove these 70 points up to 1980 and you go down with the other ones, this is what is left. A signal along 25 years with this mean value and this error, which is few parts in 10 to the minus 3. If you compare with simulated data, this is the mean value that I show you before, of the model, and this is the data, how it looks like. And this is what happens if you plot the results, the observational results, one every year, with some proxy of the solar activity. Namely, it was here chosen to be the sunspot. Very, very, very simple. So it's amazing, this anticorrelation, at least there is some clear indications of an anticorrelation of the mean value. So remember here, we have removed activity at some stage, but every year we have integrate throughout the you know, the fluctuation and just keep the mean value. So we are talking about mean values already corrected to first order for the visible activity. If something has changed in the interior of the sun, this would be well known. This is the same plot, just with these 3 points, put it here the down. Still here, this year, you can see clearly this anticorrelation. And almost just the discussion, not many time, sorry, was a bit late. Conclusions. Our measurement of the gravitational redshift is precise, 10 to the minus 3, but does not fit with the theoretical value of 5%. So this is a clear example of accuracy versus precision. We have a high precision and our accuracy is limited to 5%. The discrepancy on the blue shift, 600 instead of 636, could be explained and could lay on systematic error or ethics. We have the problem of being two isotopes in the potassium case, the 39 or the 41. We look for electronic asymmetry, the magnet, the degradation. You don't expect that the magnet, if it changes the magnet, change the crossing. But you don't expect that the magnet will change according to the solar cycle or the other way. In any case, we check it. We check for cell optics. All this we think we can account at maximum of by 4 meters per second and not no more. And I can assure you that we know very well how the instrument and the systematics at a high extent. We think that the most sensitive source of systematics is, as I told you, the incidence angle into the polarized, into the modulator. It could be also due to other solar velocity fields affecting for sun as star observations. We have uncertainties on the link shift integrated over the whole sun. We have a lot of observations, very nice, of high resolution link shifts on different, on particular areas of the sun, but here we are integrating. Also, the bisector, the asymmetry of the line, is known, is poorly known at the level we want. Sorry, we are talking about few meters per second. So these are all the possible sources. Most important, the time variations of this quantity. Well, it seems to be related with the solar activity degree, but not on the surface activity, because already we account for it. If this change is due to green shift variations, this will imply changes in the convection zone, in the physics of the convection zone. So if you change the efficiency of the convection, it will change the green shift, and therefore it will change the BGRS plus B0, the famous B0 we are measuring. So, conclusions, and this is the last one, I promise you. We make a big effort to homogenize. You can imagine that these 40 years that database, it was in different formats, media. So now everything is homogeneous. And more important, I make public available this data, the raw data, with clean everything, just to be user friendly. So anyone interested could be could have it, of course. We determine this parameter, BGRS, with a calibration in an independent technique, a discrepancy on the mean value, a 5%, a blue shift that we don't know, and again, systematics, instrumental effects, we think can only account for the 20-25% of it. The numerical model, we must and we could really improve it. We need a better parameterization of the redshift effect. And also about to know more about the asymmetry of the line. The suggested negative correlation of this parameter with the degree of solar activity, with the policy we use. If so, it will have clear implications in stellar activity characterization, because you observe the star as a whole, as you observe the sun. And also in detection of exoplanets, because this gives you a periodical signal that is related with the activity cycle. So in some stars, in younger stars, this could be of the order of exoplanet, of the order of the activities cycle. So you can have really a problem. And also, we can be dealing with changes in the solar dimensions. And finally, this is the value obtained. So thank you, and sorry for I took a bit too much. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Pere. I think we have time for maybe a couple of questions. And we are webcasting, so I'll be passing the mic.
So the effect of the magnetic field is to inhibit the efficiency of convection. So would it be the proper direction, the proper sign of the correction for the limb effects that you're talking
it's
about?
It's one of the possible explanations. It's one of the possible explanations, yes. If this is so, it will explain why this modulation of the mean value over these 25 years. Yes. It would be. Yes. Could be.
So can you put this in perspective with other measurements of the gravitational redshift?
Yes, many people. In fact, sorry, I think here. This is a paper, the first one we published on that just this year, is available, and that you will. All the bibliography relative to the historical perspective and present is there.
Okay.
So you can find all the bibliography there. Many people have tried, Snyder, Rodier, Cacciani. Cacciani tried very hard to measure this gravitational redshift, but not in extended way. That's the problem. I mean, there are, as far as I know, Steve, some campaigns to measure that. I think he obtained, because the lines he's using, I think was potassium to he used to measure the, or sodium. I think was, at some stage, I think he was potassium. So there are other measurements, but very, very short campaigns of few days just to see. But Alessandro Cassiani, for instance, developed, he was concerned about the issue, and there are some experiments, but there are no more than that, because you don't have the type of instrumentation to do it. There is no one single solar spectrometer that has this stability.
Okay. Yeah.
Not the precision during one day to measure velocity fields, but the day-to-day stability that you need. So the other measurements are made in laboratory. So they are measuring the solar gravitational from Earth using atomic beams with a laser. I mean, there is a whole lot of physics, but the solar ones were tried to measure in the 70s by Snyder, Rodier, Labonte, and Labonte, I don't know, some others. But you have few scattered points and not consistent with the measurements a long time. And I think because of the problem of the stability. You need stability day after day in the offset of the order of 1 meter per second or below, in the offset. So this is not easy.
How well do you know the rest wavelength of the potassium line? Is there a buffer gas in your gas cell? These things can shift. There's no buffer gas, there's no more impurities that could possibly shift the rest wavelength of the.
We have the problem of the isotopic shift. The isotopic shift of the 39 to 41, yes. But again, even if the optical depth of the potassium is not the same in the lab that on the sun, we don't expect to change, not in the lab at least, with this slow periodicity. So one expects, you know, depending on the temperature, for instance, of the cell, you can expect it shifts one way or another. So, but we don't have any control. The cell is very nice, the design, in the sense that it's, the convection is very nice and very homogeneous, and but it has not any other control about the, no.
I'm familiar with Joe Snyder of Oberlin College a long time ago, did a lot of work with potassium cells.
Yeah, Snyder, sorry, I didn't mention. Yes. So in these ones, it is mentioned on the paper, of course.
Quite a few years, I think.
Yes.
Measurements.
70, whatever.
Mount Wilson and other places.
Yes. Again, there are very nice rules, but this was not the sun as a star, I think. Oh yes, I'm not sure. I think it was with resolution. He measures just by sector very nicely and so on. Maybe. So this is one of the problems, yes, that now we need to integrate very nice measurements taken to see how the instrument integrates the whole sun. Yes, but sorry, Snyder was one of the other guys that, yes.
And George Isaac started in this field, didn't he?
Yeah.
Trying to measure the gravitational redshift, not the solar oscillations.
Yes, that's correct.
And then he kind of...
That's correct. Even more, they were interested in the beginning to measure gravitational waves, not gravity waves. Okay, but yes, he was very interested in the gravitational redshift. But now this...
And planets.
Excuse me? And planets. You're right, Martin, yes.
I remember that.
Yes, I remember too. Sorry, yeah.
Okay, maybe.
So what
last.
Can you say about secular trends?
Secular trends?
It's in your title.
Yes.
The title said secular.
Well, yes.
So, say something.
these observations runs over two centuries. So, in that sense, these fluctuations over 40 years are secular, because by definition, secular means more than one century. So, the secular was a way to express long term.
So, is the sun undergoing secular change or not?
Oh, we know that, but secular in the sense that at least this one was more than one century. Okay, it's has been, but in the correct way, has not been like that 200 years. We don't know. But this is a long-term effect related with the solar activities cycle. In that sense, a secular could mean 10 or 20 years.
But there's no trend. You don't see
an
upward or downward trend.
No, this is not, I mean, all the points are independent. And the same procedure has been applied to each yearly set of data. So we have not a secular one. It would be nice, because if you see a secular one, you know, increasing, one could say, the magnet is getting old.
And they do get old, they do.
Yeah, but that's not the case. We have measured twice. The original homogeneity of the magnet in the cell was 3,000, few gauss. I have two measurements of the magnet, a long time, but you know, the way to measure the magnetic field, you know, in the how you go, horseshoe, it's a double horseshoe, the magnet. So we don't have a measurement, precise measurements of magnetic field, but this will clearly gives you a trend that will all the time go up or down. But we don't see that. We don't see that. That's the whole point.
So the sun is not changing as far as you can see that.
Is changing,
just like
changing, it's changing in a regular way, at least from what these main properties, the sun as a star, is concerned, yeah. But probably I think most important or very important, I think, is the possible consequence when you look at stars, you know, to disentangle what could be a planet, the activity cycle, or what can be another type of effects. I don't know.
Okay. So Pere will be around until next Wednesday, is that correct? Tuesday?
Monday I will be.
Monday
Tuesday
will be,
I have my
okay, Monday will be his last day, so you can still find him around if you want to chat. And now I think Ali Martz will take him to CG5, so join us there if you can. If you want to ask more questions, otherwise, just thank you.
Very good.
Thank you to you for coming.